meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. First item on this evening's agenda is review of the minutes of the September 19th, 1995 meeting. Any comments, corrections?
I was absent, so I normally speak up.
I have a motion.
Motion to accept the minutes as written.
Second.
All those in favor indicate by raising right hand. Okay, motion carries. First item on this evening's agenda is, I'm sorry, next item on the agenda is correspondence. The board has received in its packet this week a letter from Mr. Boxer regarding the Highland subdivision, a letter from the town manager regarding the Highland subdivision, and a letter from the code enforcement officer regarding the Highland subdivision, as well as a memorandum from the fire chief regarding the Highland subdivision. I think it'd be appropriate if there's any issues related to those that we deal with those under the first item under new business. In addition, we have a memorandum from the fire chief regarding Maine Wireless, which we can deal with when we get to the second item under new business. And last, we have a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Hagan regarding the Perez subdivision. For those who may not be aware, the Perez subdivision has been before the planning board at several workshop meetings, but there is not yet a application before the board. And those comments are informal comments at this time, but the board will take them under consideration. With that, we'll move ahead to the first item under new business, which is the Highland subdivision amendment.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, as in the past, I'll have to excuse myself for this particular item.
Okay, thank you. As you may have noticed, the town planner is absent at this evening's meeting, so we'll ask that you bear with us. She was away at a conference in Connecticut this weekend and unfortunately had car trouble on the way back and is in her second day of repairs. So we wish her well and look forward to seeing her perhaps tomorrow. Therefore, I'll stand in giving some background to the project. And first item, as I said, was a Highland subdivision. Peter Kennedy is requesting approval for amendments, including relocating the water line to the previously approved Highland subdivision located in the area of Hunts Point Road in Winding Way. This is an amendment to previously approved subdivision under section 16-2-5, and also a wetlands alteration permit completeness is required under section 19-3-9. What I'd like to do at this time is have the applicant, if you would choose to get up and make a brief presentation to the proposed changes that you have before the board this evening, and then after that, we'll go into board discussion.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Stephen Moore. I'm a landscape architect with Moore & Sheridan here this evening on behalf of Peter Kennedy. As the chair has indicated, what I'd like to do is just briefly walk you through what our requests are that are before you this evening, and then talk a little bit about the information that was submitted, excuse me, and then respond to the comments in Maureen's memo, and then turn it back to the board for discussion. As Maureen has pointed out in her memo, what we're seeking this evening is a preliminary review and discussion of the proposed amendments to the subdivision plan. And then, along with the amendments, we are seeking to move the water line, which has necessitated a wetlands alteration permit. And we are seeking completeness from you of our permit application so we can move both of these items forward as this board sees fit. In the plans that were submitted to you, what we have outlined are a couple of changes on the approved plan. Specifically, what we're looking to do is change the alignment of the water line within the proposed subdivision, and then change the existing road system within the existing subdivision to shorten Barn Palm Road. Very briefly, in the approved subdivision, which this board reviewed 2 years ago, the proposed 8-inch water line, which would provide a water loop for the entire Broad Cove subdivision, was to extend from Two Lights Road and follow the emergency access right-of-way through and out to Wantigan Bay.
Excuse me, Steve, is there any way you can move that up onto the pin board behind you, because that's being blocked by the podium?
That.
Okay, thank you.
As approved and existing to be built right now, that water line would extend within the green area and out through the yellow road here. What we have asked the board to approve is a revised alignment which would allow the water line to be built up into the center of Lot 4, and then extend on an easement through Lot 4, and then through an existing right-of-way, and connect into Hunts Point Road. This realignment serves two functions. It allows PETA to proceed with the construction of that water line and avoids having to build approximately an additional 400 or 500 feet of water line in this alignment. Secondarily, and I think most importantly, what it does is it provides that important water line loop for the entire subdivision. And as pointed out in Chief McGoldrick's letter, you still achieve a considerable increase in the flows, which is what the chief was looking for and what the water district was looking for within the Broad Cove subdivision. This realignment, the chief has looked at, you've seen his memo. The Portland Water District has reviewed this and they have approved this proposed alignment. You haven't seen that correspondence yet, but we have a letter to that effect from the Water District. As a part of this proposed change, you recall that we spoke at the workshop about still examining wells versus public water for all the lots within the subdivision. We have been working with the district and have been able to provide easements along the top of Lot 4 that will give Lot 5 and Lot 4 their public water. So all of the lots will still have public water as was shown on the previously approved plan. As a part of this water line plan, we had submitted as Attachment C information that outlined the details of existing soils boundaries and wetland boundaries within the original subdivision plan. And the water line in this alignment crosses through two fingers of wetlands. And they are shown schematically here on this plan in dark. If you look through your 8.5 by 11 attachments, you'll see an attachment C that outlines the areas that are impacted by the water line passing through these wetland fingers. Mr. McVane has submitted a letter in the package to you indicating that this is a permitted activity within that type of wetland. We looked at various alternative routings for the water line. And in looking at the alternative routings, the only one that we had was either stay where it was existing within the emergency access right-of-way or continue up on the one strip that PETA still controls through a fee interest. On the approved subdivision plan, the strip that runs up and connects to Hunts Point Road is an old 50-foot right-of-way that was part of the original subdivision, that in the conveyance of these properties to Greater Portland, that 50-foot strip was conveyed in fee to PETA, so PETA has control of that. That really is our only other means of access to existing water mains in the Broad Cove subdivision. So that's where we had to look for that routing. In looking at the wetlands impact, we aligned this proposed line as much as we could to the west to avoid impacts to the maximum amount possible, so that what we're looking at is a request to the board for an impact of 912 square feet to the wetlands. Now, as a part of the work, we'll be passing this underground service through and then reconstructing that area and reseeding that and treating that back as a wetlands vegetative cover, but it will be disturbed as a part of this activity, hence the wetlands application. That focuses on the one significant change, which is the water line. The second amendment that we are proposing to the board is to look at Farm Pond Road, which in the approved plan extends up and in and was a cul-de-sac, and that entire road was approximately 750 feet long. What we're looking to do is shorten that road and take off about 350 feet of road length and eliminate the cul-de-sac. This would extend the emergency access way over the length of what was previously paved and limit the paved area just to the area shown in yellow here. This doesn't affect in any way the existing lot configurations or the way that the house or building windows sit on the properties. What it does do is it keeps the access to Lot 6 as it was existing, but it changes the access to Lot 5 so that it comes in from the existing Jordan Fawn Pond Road from two lanes. So that's really the essence of the two changes that we bring before you and which you're reviewing under that subdivision amendment. I've already talked about a little bit about the wetlands alteration permit. We submitted three attachments with our application A, B, and C that showed the two alignments, the existing and proposed, and then also outlines the specific location of the proposed easement over Lot 4 and how the water line sits within that proposed easement and then on to the existing fee interest owned by Peter. We had submitted that information, and the town has on record the soils information, the wetlands boundary, and the storm drainage information, all of which were contained in the original package. Because this is an underground utility that we will be restoring the surface when we're done, we're not looking at any substantive change to stormwater. The soils and wetland boundaries will remain as was previously documented with you. So we had looked at that supporting information to stand in support of our application to you. And I would offer those as comments with respect to Maureen's questions about completeness. The last thing to discuss is really just the whole issue of the subdivision and proceeding and some of the issues that are raised in the various memos. Maureen had pointed out five or six comments to you, and I'll start off with some of the easiest ones. Per the chief's comments, we will be renaming both ends of that road that are going to be paved and open to the public Jordan Farm Pond Roads. We won't have the conflicting names. So that's pointed out in Maureen's memo and the chief's memo, and we will make that change on the recording plat. I have to apologize to you for what I'll call a Scribner's error, which was done by someone on the design team outside of our office who labeled that private as opposed to public. And obviously, that easement has already been, or the right-of-way has been deeded to the town and will be called a public access. It is a public access way, emergency access way, and that has been changed and will be showing up on the final plans to you. With respect to Maureen's comment and request for discussion about the water lines along the northern edge of Lots 4 and 5, they do rest within that existing drainage easement area. Our thinking on that alignment was that in order to shape and create the drainage easement in that area, we had to do disturbance to the site. That's something the board had looked at and approved previously. Our feeling was if we were disturbing that area, it would be best to locate our water lines within that existing disturbed area so we don't further impact other adjoining areas. And hence the location along that northern edge of Lot 4 will just help us keep our impacts minimized on this project. The Portland Water District, as I've mentioned, has okayed the alignment, and the proposed water main relocation as well as the easements to serve Lots 4 and 5 will provide documentation to you of that. I have copies if you wish to see that tonight. The last three points, I think, are fairly straightforward. The deeds that are mentioned in the paperwork from Maureen will be submitted to you with our next application. And as far as all the necessary changes that are spelled out by T.Y. Lin, we will be addressing those in our technical application to you. And all of Fred's comments will be corrected, including clearing up these inconsistencies between approved plans and revised plans. So we will be picking that up and bringing that forward to you and making those changes to the town's satisfaction. So with that, I'll turn it back to the chair and open up for discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Steve. Just to remind the board, this evening we're dealing with the issue of subdivision, amendment to a subdivision, and the completeness with respect to the wetland alteration permit. In addition, the wetland alteration permit requires that we hold a public hearing. We may or may not request to hold a public hearing with respect to the revisions to the subdivision plan. And as per Maureen's recommendation, we should treat both parts of the application the same. That is, we don't approve one separately since each is tied to the other. With that, I guess the way I'd like to proceed is that we would review the completeness issues under the wetland alteration permit and see if anyone has any concerns or questions with respect to Maureen's comments or the engineer's notes, and then hold a vote as to whether or not we deem it complete. Are there any questions? Mr. Edsel?
No questions. I just assume that, and maybe I shouldn't assume it, that the wetlands alteration permit completeness E is no. We had pretty extensive vegetative over the stuff description at the original application, and I assume that that's why it's not repeated here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have any problem with that at all.
Any other?
No other questions. No other comments.
Any other questions with respect to completeness? I understand that a lot of these issues have been addressed or are in the process of being addressed. There's nothing here that appears to be terribly substantive with respect to the issue of completeness that I can see. I would like a clarification with respect to Maureen's question about the delineation of the lot line for Lot 6, which in our plans extends to the, call it the southerly side of the access road rather than the northerly side.
Again, that was a mistake in Owen Haskell's office in terms of delineation of the heavy line, and our intent all along has been to leave Lot 6 as it was originally approved. So there will be no alteration to that right-of-way alignment. It will be as originally approved and not as shown on your plan.
Okay. Is it clear to everyone where the gravel access roads for the back lots is going to be as part of this proposal? Could you show us on the plan?
I had a question in that I didn't follow what you were saying about the south side of Lot 6.
On our plan, Steve, mm-hmm. Lot 6, the heavy line that defines Lot 6 extends to the lower side of the access road,
right,
or the right-of-way,
mm-hmm.
and it, in fact, should be on the upper side of what's called the northerly side.
So Lot 6 does not cross over that right-of-way?
It's a divided lot, as far as I understand.
Oh, okay.
That is correct. It was approved as a divided lot and will remain as a divided lot.
One other question with respect to completeness is the issue of alternative routes. Is it indeed the case with the previous alignment that there would be no additional alteration of wetlands?
In the original alignment, the water line was set in the road so that the water line and the road's wetlands alterations were one and the same, so that all of the wetlands alterations required by the water line were integral to the road itself. By breaking this alignment out here, we are in fact increasing that disturbance by 912 square feet. I think the couple of key issues are that as we work our way through and then restore that surface, we'll be looking at restoring those areas back to their native natural vegetative cover. So it won't be a permanent wetlands lost as it was in the roadway.
Okay, thank you. I think also for the record, I'd like to go back. I'm not going to read the letters that we have, but I think for the record it's important to point out that we do have in front of us a letter from Dan Boxer, who's a direct abutter, a letter from the town manager regarding the Highlands that had been requested by the board, and a letter from the code enforcement officer and the fire chief. Any member of the public that's interested in those is certainly welcome to see Maureen and to review those correspondences. With that, do I hear a motion?
Another question.
Yes, Roy.
I just have a question about Hunts Point Road. Is that the way it is today, or has that been extended a little further? I'm just thinking about the abutters. The last house that we see up above there is Bruce Gesk, I guess. Has Hunts Point Road been extended further, do you know?
What you see on the plan here is the existing limits of Hunts Point Road. So it hasn't been extended any further than what's shown right on this plan here.
Fine, thank you.
Do you have a motion?
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Edsel?
For a motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and the material submitted and the facts presented, application of Peter Kennedy for a wetlands alteration permit for the location of a water line in the Highland subdivision be deemed complete.
Motion. I have a second. Any discussion? I would like to add a condition that he comply with the requirements in the engineer's letter in terms of consistency in the plans. And also, as presented this evening, that the corrections and other inconsistencies that were discussed are corrected.
As a matter of completeness?
Yes.
I'm certainly willing to add that.
Thank you.
Agreed.
I would ask that Steve just address that issue, sort of wave a hand over all of the town engineer's comments that you're willing to do that. I mean, are there any issues at all in Fred's letter that you find difficult to comply with?
We don't have any issues with Fred's comments as presented.
Okay, thank you. The motion's been seconded. An amendment? Any further discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Okay, it's been deemed complete. Yes, at this point, what I'd like to do is open it for further board discussion with related to any issues with respect to the subdivision or any further questions regarding the wetland application. Mark?
I have a question for the applicant in terms of the water service, which will be result in a change in the property lines across Lot 5 to Lot 6, across the northerly limit there. You described it in your letter and in your presentation as an easement. On the plans, it appears that the actual fee ownership lot line of Lot 6 goes over to that water main, over to the new easement that cuts across Lot 4.
No. I'm sorry, go ahead.
So could you maybe give a little more detail on how that works and then how the water service to Lot 6 is arranged?
Again, not to pick on anyone in particular for following through on plans, but the plan lot lines obviously were misdrawn on that, and the easements across the top of 4 are intended to be just for water access for Lot 5, so the fee interest of 5 will stay within the approved boundaries, not as shown on this plan. Water access to Lot 6 is intended to come from Jordan Farm Road via a line extension within Jordan Farm Road, coming from Winding Way.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Mr. Edsel?
Just a comment, and my understanding is that for a wetlands alteration permit, we have to hold a public hearing.
That's correct.
It's a requirement, so we'll be hearing some public comment in another meeting. I would just say, as to prepare the applicant, that at least a couple of different letters have mentioned performance guarantee, that there are some guidelines or restrictions during for time frame in which improvements must be completed and so forth. I would just suggest that you draw some of those up on your own terms and at least be able to present us with the amount of performance guarantees, at least the estimate in your mind. I don't know, sometimes that is a case of being, who typically approves a performance guarantee?
Town manager.
Town manager. I'm just saving, you know, one more meeting, so you might as well get that. That seems to be an issue. It will be an issue. Might as well prepare those in advance. I think also, before we forget it, okay, I see we do have a motion for a public hearing.
Okay. It's not direct, I have an indirect comment that I'll offer up to the board, but I think once we deal with the issue of a public hearing on the wetland alteration permit, it's perhaps more applicable to the subdivision, but we have a letter from the town manager supporting the alignment of the road and the shortening of the roadway. I would certainly offer that up for board discussion at this juncture. This has been what I believe to be the last opportunity to somehow provide a second means of egress out of Broad Cove subdivision, and as that emergency gravel access road gets longer and the paved sections get shorter, the realization of that, I think, gets farther and farther into the future. With any respect, why don't we move on to the issue of a public hearing regarding the wetland alteration permit? Any general discussion with respect to that by the board? If not, could I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I'd like to offer the following motion. Be it ordered that the application of Peter Kennedy for a wetlands alteration permit for the location of a water line in the Highlands subdivision and an amendment to a previously approved subdivision be tabled to the regular November 21st, 1995 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Okay, just to be clear, I don't think the motion states specifically that that public hearing is for both the subdivision amendment as well as the wetland alteration permit. What we could do is we could restrict this to the wetland alteration permit and then have another motion with respect to the subdivision. I think that would be appropriate. Those are two separate permits.
They are two separate things, but they're both mentioned separately as amendment to a previously approved subdivision and the location of the or the wetlands alteration permit. If the board wants to not have a public hearing on one and have it on the other, I think the way it's worded right now includes both.
Okay.
Is that the way you read it, Mark?
Yes.
All right. We all agree that the intent here is that we would have a public hearing with that motion on both the subdivision and the wetland alteration permit application. Any discussion on the issue with respect to subdivision public hearing? I think that the changes are fairly substantive with respect to the subdivision approval, and if nothing else, if there's confusion with respect to the alignment of the easements and so forth, I think if this is certainly an appropriate time to provide public input on that, so I would certainly support that motion as well. Do we have a second on the motion?
Second.
Any further discussion?
You mentioned up as an issue of discussion, or just brought it up for, I guess, the issue of public access, emergency access. It was a very key issue at the time when the original subdivision was approved, but I'm not sure how much of a discussion needs to be brought up again. I mean, it seems to be a little bit of a political hot potato. Involved a lot of time, a lot of meetings, specifically around that one issue, but it is a major concern. I wasn't on the majority side of the way it turned out, but I'm also not sure that this is the juncture at which to try to turn that around.
I don't think I'm interested in reopening or revisiting that issue. What I see here is two quite separate issues, the alignment of the water line and then somehow this realignment of the roadway. And if the bottom line here, and I don't mean to imply anything by this, but there may be other extenuating circumstances that brings this proposal here other than just the alignment of the water. I mean, I would have to assume the savings in construction that may indicate that there's an issue of the cost of the development versus the ability to develop it. That discussion about the length of that roadway and the length of the emergency access gravelway was a lengthy one and involved quite a bit of public input, if I remember correctly. And I think the compromise was met, and I don't see at all how the realignment of a waterway and the whole reconfiguration of this roadway seem to fall hand in hand, and my greatest fear is that at some point it becomes evident to everyone that there is a need, for whatever circumstances, to connect this subdivision to Two Lights Road. And the town then is left with a much greater cost than it would be under the originally approved subdivision. So I see there's some purpose here to having a discussion about the length of the paved section of road. As I understand, the alignment is the same, but the paved section is quite different. Both pro and con. We have a letter document supporting the alignment of the road as you're proposing to amend it. So I'm not at all implying that the only public input that we're going to get is going to be to go back to the original alignment. It could very well be people who support the configuration that we have before us this evening. Any further discussion on the motion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Passes unanimously. So would you be prepared to submit all of the application materials for the next regularly scheduled meeting of the Planning Board?
Yes, we are.
Okay, thank you. Then we'll schedule it, Alice, for the public hearing for the next regular meeting of the Planning Board.
I just assume that everyone's familiar with the site, and I don't know if all the board members have been on that site.
That's good.
I don't want to belabor the point with a site walk, because I've certainly been there enough times, but it's something we sort of skipped over a little bit, but I don't, it's up to the other boards, other board members. Or we can go there on our own.
Yeah.
And take a look.
Roy and I have walked the site with the Conservation Commission.
Okay.
And I was there today myself this afternoon.
I think we walk on our own. That's appropriate. Any questions?
I think we're all set. Peter, all right. Do you have questions for the board?
Right. Thank
you.
Thank you very much. Next item on this evening's agenda is a Maine Wireless site plan and RP3 wetland permit application. Maine Wireless is requesting approval of the addition of an antenna and utility building to an existing tower located off Spurwink Avenue. We'll be reviewing this for RP3 permit completeness under section 19-3-9 and site plan review completeness under section 19-2-10. Just for a bit of clarification, the RP3 zone that we're speaking about is although it's a resource protection, is implied a wetland. The issue here is not wetland, but it is continuous slopes greater than 20% over a certain percentage area of the property. I guess what I'd like to do at this point is to have the applicant make a brief presentation with respect to the proposal and any changes to the existing parcel. And then we can review the completeness summary review.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Lawrence McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with Sebago Technics. I seem to be here an awful lot recently. with me tonight is Doug Edwards from Maine Wireless Limited Partnership, the applicant for this project. I think Maureen's staff report kind of summarizes the project, and I'll run through it. Our submittal letter provide some detailed information. So what I thought I would do is give a quick overview and then maybe try to answer any questions that the board has. The project presented before you is here for site plan review and an RP3 permit. And as Mr. Emery indicated, the RP3 permit is based on slopes instead of wetlands out there. Maine Wireless is proposing to install a 12 by 26 foot precast structure to house electronic equipment, install a 2.5 inch wide by 94.5 inch tall gray fiberglass antenna, and install a backup 35-kilowatt generator and a propane tank on an existing cellular tower site. This site's located at 351 Spurwink Avenue. The current owner of the property is Herbert and Doris Strout. The facility that's up there now was approved back in 1989, I believe, for Maine Cellular.
Correct.
Those folks installed a 180-foot cellular tower, also installed a 12-foot by 32-foot precast building, basically to house electronic equipment. There is a small propane tank located on the site. What I've tried to do is kind of outline the site itself. This is the existing 180-foot tower. This is the existing building. Over here is the propane tank. This is a gravel pad where the facility sits on for access around the site. While I'm on that subject, in your packets, there's a letter from the fire chief about access. Doug had an opportunity to meet with him out there, and they took the hook and ladder truck and went all the way around. Maureen's been out, so the fire chief and her haven't been able to connect, but I'm sure they will between now and when we come back. Again, the existing tower, existing building, and a propane tank. Maine Wireless will be installing a new precast shelter for their electronic equipment. Here would be a small generator. This is basically a backup generator in the event of a power failure. There's a 500-gallon propane tank, which will supply the fuel for the generator. The tower itself will have, in which we drew in a sec elevation over here. And what you can see on here is up there now, there's an existing antenna array, and Maine Wireless would be installing this antenna array here at an elevation of 160 feet. Your packet shows what those antennas would look like. They're 2.5 inches wide, 94.5 inches tall. They basically look like a very small airfoil. They're gray in color, and they're made of fiberglass. Is that correct? And that is the extent of the project. The building will set. There is no earthwork for the building. The only earthwork will be to install a new underground electric service over to the building. Basically, it's a prefabricated unit that comes to the site. It sets on a peystone bedding, or depending on the time of the year when the construction starts, it could be on a concrete slab, which is placed directly on grade. So there is very little earthwork associated with the site. We did ask for some waivers in the application. Basically, those pertain to drainage and erosion control. They pertain to depicting the full access road and buffering, which is existing on the site. I understand that Fred Morin has reviewed the application and for those waivers and felt they were appropriate. I think Maureen has looked at those also. The site is, just to give you an overview of the site, as you can see, these are the contours on the site. This shows the slopes of 20% or greater. The site's sloping this way down towards Spurwink Avenue. It's presently wooded with the exception of the area here. The rest is mature mixed tree growth in that area. And when I was out there in July, plenty of bugs. And I think that about summarizes the application. Again, Doug Edwards is here with me tonight, and we'll try to answer questions you may have.
Thank you. Why don't we start by doing a determination of completeness? Start with the site plan review. Does everyone have that in front of them? Any questions? Mr. Edsel?
I went over this when you were before us in workshop, and I guess I didn't get a real clear answer then. I haven't done any more research on it. I don't see any more answers in here regarding the right title and interest through the leasehold interest through Maine Cellular. How Maine Wireless became the successor in interest or whatever that relationship is, I guess, you know, I don't see a lease agreement. I see a letter from the owner of the land saying that he does lease to Maine Cellular.
You should also see a letter of intent from Maine Cellular addressed to Maine Wireless.
Right. I guess my, if you can go back over again, how Maine Wireless came into the position that you're in now to operate instead of Maine Cellular.
I guess I don't understand your question. Are you concerned, are you asking about our FCC granted authority or this particular piece of property?
No, not this particular, but just in general, how Maine Wireless got ownership of those rights.
Oh, okay.
Would you mind stepping to the podium and addressing the board? Please introduce yourself.
The Portland Cellular Partnership, which did business as Maine Cellular, was granted a license in, you have to forgive me, but the dates are approximate 1987, if memory serves me correctly. And at the time that their application was granted by the Federal Communications Commission, the license was, or the grant actually, was contested by the Northeast Cellular Telephone Company. Over the next period of 7 or 8 years, the FCC dismissed the motion to deny the application. Northeast Cellular pursued it in federal court. The federal court then found for Northeast Cellular and handed it back to the FCC and had them re-examine it. Over a period of years, the FCC re-examined Northeast's position with regard and ultimately granted Northeast Cellular the license. At the time that the court sent the application back to the commission, Maine Cellular's license was in effect replaced with an interim operating permit. Mm-hmm. And then when they made their finding, their interim permit was canceled and Northeast Cellular was granted a construction permit.
Has Portland Cellular Partnership or Maine Cellular filed any litigation, any suit to regain their interest?
Absolutely.
They have?
Yes.
What's the status of that litigation? I
can't answer that. I don't know. That's in the hands of our FCC attorneys in Washington.
I wish our legal counsel was here, because it's a kind of a winding road. And what liability the town has by granting improvements during the time period of litigation. I suppose we do grant those approvals with litigation pending, even though, you know, we're looking at, as it was before, 6 or 7 years. And so my question would be, what happens if Northeast, I'm sorry, Portland, whichever it was.
Okay. So your question is what happens or what occurs at the site in the event that that Maine Cellular regains the license?
Mm.
Maine Cellular is renting they're renting today to one tenant, which is Cellular One or Vanguard. Mm-hmm. Vanguard has moved into the existing building and used the existing antenna arrays at the top of the tower. And I understand from Maine Cellular that there's a condition in that lease that will require Vanguard to vacate that space in the event that Maine Cellular regains their license. What our position will be is if we lose our license, then we no longer have a business and we'll be liquidating our assets, and certainly we will be selling that building and its contents. And that's very simple, because you just pick it up with a crane, put it on a trailer truck, and drive out the driveway with it.
Well, yeah.
I think Steve, your question's a weighty one, and I think it's perhaps reasonable to ask that this issue be forwarded to Maureen as an issue that we need clarification in terms of completeness. We have a letter from the property owner. I don't know if any of us can follow the trail of who owns what and when, but...
So what, so help me understand the issue. What is your question, so we can provide you with an answer, or what are you looking for? What do you want the answer to be?
Your right title and interest to make the improvements on the site without a lease. I mean, you have a letter of intent.
Right.
To sign a lease.
Mm-hmm. And the letter of intent states that upon planning board approval of a plan, that the lease will...
Do they have a copy of the lease ready to sign?
We have a draft that we're working out the details on.
Are you looking for a draft copy of that lease?
I think just to be safe. I mean, I'm sure everybody wants to continue in business, but as they found out, it wasn't always...
Right. Well, what are...
Not always the person...
What are you being safe from? What would you like to see? I mean, is there something in that lease? I mean, we could cut this process short if you could tell me what it is in the lease that you're looking for, and if you have a concern and I can have it added to the lease, I'd be happy to do it.
The other issue is if any of your improvements in collateral are secured debt.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean yes, they do?
Yes.
Yeah. So it is not necessarily just as easy to pick up that collateral and move it from a site?
It will be. I mean, whether the entity Maine Wireless liquidates it or our creditors liquidate it, moving the material is... easy.
I think it would be easiest just to pose it as a condition, mm-hmm. that Maureen follows up with town legal counsel. They're satisfied with that.
Okay.
That's fine with me.
Okay. So what is, I don't understand, what is the condition?
Well, I will propose that there's a condition that simply that Maureen, the town planner, request of our town legal counsel, a statement from them what they feel comfortable with as far as proof of a lease, whether they feel satisfied with a letter of intent in that situation, that's fine. You know, if I guess I just want a matter of record to discuss the issue. If legal counsel says that's fine, letter of intent is fine, no, we want to see a copy of the lease, no, we want to see a signed lease before any improvement's done, let mm-hmm. them make that decision.
And I would certainly agree that we would provide a signed lease before any improvements or any work has begun. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. What is there, so I guess I still don't understand, is there some specific language in this lease that you're looking for that, I mean, that maybe you've used in the past or other projects here on the Cape?
Well, I can't think of an instance when we know that there's litigation underway,
mm-hmm.
in progress, in a leasehold interest, where we approve a site plan approval based on leasehold interest that's under litigation.
Mm.
You know, so there's no precedent verbiage as such. I just want to make sure that that's clear.
Okay.
To our legal counsel.
Great.
Okay. Going down the site plan review checklist, are there any other items that the board has questions about? I mean, there's several waivers here, and they seem fairly straightforward. I think for the record, if Owens could just simply answer the question as to why the building setback lines aren't indicated on the plan.
The overall parcel that Herb Stroud owns is quite substantial, much bigger than the area where the improvements are. This is basically up into the central portion of the site. When the site was originally approved back in 1989, there's a copy of the site plan that was approved at that time in with your packet. And since our improvements are going to be limited to within the existing developed areas, we're not proposing any new construction outside of that envelope. So that's the basis of our request.
Okay. Mr. Etzel.
But you heard me sigh. I guess it was just, have we had instances before where the setbacks are from leasehold interest? I mean, do the terms of the lease describe the property?
Well, there's a lease.
With Maine Cellular?
I don't have underlying ones.
I guess I'm...
You know what I'm saying? I think we all assume that, you know, this is an enormous site, and so that's why we're not measuring large...
I don't know the answer to that. I know that there's a lease line that's shown on, was on the original site plan, which we have now shown on this plan.
Yeah, we see that here. I think that's, again, a question. I don't think it's an issue of completeness, it's an issue of clarification. We'll just simply ask that Maureen provide us with an opinion with respect to whether there's any precedent for providing a building setback line from a lease line rather than a regular property line. Did you get that, Steve, for your motion? Any other items? Okay. That deals with site plan review. Let's see, do we have a checklist for wetland alteration? Yes, RP3 on the second page. Key items there. Okay, I mean, the issue is, we have a letter from the code enforcement officer confirming that it's an RP3 wetland. In this instance, it's my understanding that actually the RP3 wetland works in your favor, not against you. You need the RP3 wetland in order to proceed.
That's correct.
It's an issue again, but I mean, again, I agree with you. It's not an issue of completeness, but dimensions of lot. Yes, the applicant only has certain rights, title, and interest in a certain dimension of the lot. You don't have rights to the entire lot.
When you ask about the dimensional, the lease lot, you're talking about a physical description of that lease lot?
I would assume that it is some type of Schedule A in the lease to describe.
Can I ask, Mr. Trapp? In the underlying lease,
if they had to be moved to accommodate a building setback line, if that were the case. Okay. Yeah, okay. All right. No further questions on that. All right. Could we have a motion? Mr. Parkhurst?
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Maine Wireless for a site plan review and an RP3 permit of 2 antennas and a utility building located at 351 Spurwink Avenue be deemed complete.
The motion, do I have a second? Mr. Carlson?
Second.
Any further discussion on the motion? Would you care to add any?
Actually saying it's not an issue of completeness. I think whether just by contacting Maureen, do you feel as chair that it's more important to amend the completeness issue, or do we take another vote on this tonight?
We take is on the public hearing.
Yeah.
You know, in the worst case situation, it could be a legal pitfall for an applicant, I suppose. I'm not real sure. I think because Maureen isn't here and to keep the record straight, I think perhaps as part of the motion, rather than saying it's a completeness issue, we're just asking for clarification as part of the motion. That'd be appropriate?
Agreed.
I would ask that the motion be amended for two conditions. Number one, that through the town planner or that the town planner receive advice or statement from our town legal counsel regarding the issue of importance of setback from lot lines in a leasehold interest. And number two, that the town planner receive a statement or advice from town legal counsel regarding the issue of the board approving site plan, or, yeah, approving site plan, approving a site plan application for a leasehold interest that is in litigation.
Our leasehold interest isn't really litigation, it's just our cellular operating.
It's true, that the
We could still operate this site without an FCC cellular license. We can operate it in other radio or wireless services.
There are other issues to involve.
Can we just put that under the umbrella of right title and interest, a clarification on the issue of right title and interest?
Let's leave it there.
So that is a completeness issue?
It's a clarification for completeness. It's not, we're not going to suggest that we're denying the completeness because we don't have that information. We're just asking Maureen for clarification on that item.
It seems to me would be more appropriate to leave the completeness issue alone and lump those suggestions that Mr. Edsel has made into the next section, which will be taken up at the next meeting, and by that time, clarification could be provided.
With respect to the motion on the public hearing?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Doesn't matter to me.
That's fine.
Okay. Hold that thought, Alice.
All right. Okay, thank you. We have a motion. It's been seconded with no amendments. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Deemed complete.
Thank you.
Now that we're deemed complete, are there any further questions of the applicant or any additional information, any other comments? As it's noted in the packet, we do have to hold a public hearing for the RP3 wetland permit. Therefore, could I entertain a motion with respect to public hearing? Mark?
I have a question on further discussion. For our next meeting. The application noted that the generator, which will be exercised weekly, will have a silencer. Is it possible to obtain actual sound level data in terms of decibel at property lot lines?
At the measured or predicted?
Projected or what you anticipate?
Sure. At what? At the lease line or at the property boundaries?
At the property boundaries.
I think that's available.
Yeah, if you could find that, I'd be interested in that, because that is probably the only impact from this project, as near as I can tell, on the surrounding land.
Any further questions? I have 2 points for clarification. You note a propane, 500-gallon propane tank. I assume that's above ground?
Yes, sir, it is.
Yes, that's what I assume. And the other propane tank will continue in use?
Correct.
Okay. And, of course, those are all installed according to code requirements and so forth?
Correct, with the right separation and separation ignition points.
Okay. With that, we have a motion on the public hearing. Mr. Parkers?
Before I make the motion, somehow it seems to me, I understand we're trying to get a clarification or something, but it seems to me we're dealing with site plan review here. It's really actually none of our business what is going on between the applicant and whatever litigation he may be in. We chose to sort of skirt around the issue with the most recent application that we approved that had that sort of potential there. We chose to basically just skirt it completely because it really was not part of our purview. And I have to make the suggestion that probably this is not part of our purview as well.
I don't know enough about the situation to make a decision. I don't think that it can hurt to ask the planner to refer to the town's legal counsel an opinion as to whether or not that's an issue. I think the difference is in here we're talking about right title and interest versus the issue of exactly where a boundary, the other issue that you're referring to is a boundary line. I don't think anyone was disputing the right title and interest of the applicant or the person who owned the land. It was a matter of where that boundary line was falling on the face of the earth.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Strout?
May I speak?
Yes, you may.
Your initial application, all that was, I think, clearly spelled out.
I think what...
The issue is...
Yeah, I think what makes this a unique situation is that you're not applying for the improvements, and they're not going to reside with you, that they're leasehold improvements, and that makes the whole issue of right title and interest a little removed. There are issues here that are very complicated that I'm not aware of. And I, again, this, it's not an issue of completeness. It won't affect the time schedule. I just think a planning board member has brought up a question that none of us knows the answer to, and there's not apparently a clear precedent one way or the other that any of us are aware of. So I think it is appropriate to simply instruct the town planner to ask a question of the town attorney. Is this something that the board needs either to be concerned about first and foremost, or secondly, if so, what nature of information is appropriate for the applicant to provide to allay us of those concerns or to set the public record straight?
May I ask one question?
Certainly.
Do I understand that we're going to revisit the issue of wetland?
Of wetland?
Of the wetland issue.
No, certainly not. No, we're not contesting the issue of the wetland at all.
Mr. Chairman, I certainly don't mind if Steve or Mr. Parkhurst would rather it not be an amendment to a motion. As I said before, I simply bring it up. It is a little, I understand Mr. Parkhurst's point of view, and it's not, I did not bring up all the issues of your specific situation. It's more a case, and we have brought it up before, is it appropriate for the planning board to vote on certain issues in certain instances, or what's the right way to do that? In other words, is the issue of boundary lines and setbacks from leasehold interest boundaries pertinent to a site plan review? Now, that's sort of a global issue. You know, I'm interested to see, because we don't have a lot of ground leases or leasehold interests that come before us. The other issue, dealing with litigation, we've certainly had other instances where litigation is involved, but I guess, again, it's a global issue. Not that I want to bring up the issues of this situation specifically. It's just, it is a different situation where I think in essence you're a subtenant to the original lessee.
I'm ready to make the motion now.
Okay.
Okay, be it ordered that the application be tabled to the regular November 2nd, 19th. Is that the correct date?
No, 21st it should be, I believe.
21st. Excuse me. Be it ordered that the application be tabled to the regular November 21st, 1995 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Okay, we have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Thank you.
November
22nd. 21st.
21st. Thank you.
Thank you.
Short night.
Oh, we're not done yet.
Oh, you guys?
Are there any further issues as part of the regular planning board meeting this evening? I have a motion for adjournment.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Yeah.
Thank you. Meeting is adjourned. We have a second agenda for a workshop this evening, which